Hello and welcome to this special justice episode of Living Black. I'm Carla Grant. Today we take a look back at some of the high-profile justice stories featured in the program in 2014. First, last year marked the 10th anniversary of the death in custody of Palm Island man Murungi Dumuji. The death of the 36-year-old sparked a riot on the island. More than a decade later, his family and community are still seeking justice.
Cameron's that side, Eric here. He was like our backbone of the family, and we're backbone for him and his little crew and that. Today we're here to be strong for each other and for our brother. We will never forget him whatsoever for anyone, no matter who it is, black, white or Brenda. We will never ever forget our baby brother. They took him away from us.
It's just not fair. Now he should be here with us.
10 years have passed since their brother Cameron, also known as Murungi, was found dead in a cell in the Palm Island police station. He'd suffered a cut above his right eye, 4 broken ribs, his portal vein had been ruptured, and his liver almost cleaved in two.
I was all traumatised, like all in shock.
Yeah. I just kept saying, Jane, you're not telling lies. Jane, when she rang me, I was in Manor. I said, stop it, you're telling lies. And I rang the hospital, eh? They said that nobody died, and then I started shaking bad. And
how did you actually find out?
I rang the police station. Chris Early answered, and he asked me who I was, how I was related, where was I ringing from. And then after I gave him all my information, he handed me on to somebody else, Leaf, I think, Sergeant Leaf. And then he just said, oh, we can't talk about it, and just hung up.
Cameron Dumuji was picked up and arrested on the 19th of November 2004 for allegedly causing a public nuisance. Local man Lex Watton was there on the day.
Apparently Cameron was drinking over in the house behind the trees there.
Mm-hmm.
He walked down here, and at that particular time, the officer Early and Bingrew, the police liaison, they brought Roy Bramwell, his partner, back to get some medication here in this particular house. While they were here, they grabbed the other witness, that the bloke that was in the cell when Cameron died. Young Patrick Bramwell, he was apparently on the ground, he asleep, so they just picked him up and put him in the police car, from what I understand. And so Cameron actually saw that, and he said, oh, something to the effect of, why are you picking up one of your own, you know? Police liaison said to Cameron, go along, otherwise we'll have to pick you up. According to Early and his statements, Cameron's supposed to have sworn at Bingrew, but that wasn't the case at all. So he was taking offence on behalf of Bingrew. He grabbed Cameron, and Cameron asked him, what you locking me up for? And I'd done nothing, and so he was intent on actually incarcerating him. Apparently he slammed him in the police car. That's where he ended up with the cut up on the top of the eye, something like that in some of the reports.
He was arrested by Senior Sergeant Chris Hurley, accompanied by the Indigenous Liaison Police Officer Lloyd Bengaroo, and was taken into custody. 40 minutes later, Cameron was found dead in his cell.
We just knew deep down something else happened. The officer in charge did something to him, and he wasn't going to be accounted for. Still not accounted for, still no closure.
In the days that followed, family and locals were desperate for answers. A week later, the results of the autopsy report were made public by the then mayor, Erica Kyle. After hearing about the gravity of Cameron's injuries, the community became angry and a riot erupted. Mayor Alf Lacey remains critical about the way in which the situation was handled.
Peter Beattie should have taken more responsibility. That type of incident in any community requires the proper authority to deal at that level and feel that that council at that particular point in time was just put in a very awkward situation. And other incidents that happen like this in the future, then the responsibility needs to be put in the government's lap, not in the community's lap.
On the afternoon of the riot, a state of emergency was declared. 80 police officers, including the Tactical Response Group, were called in to quell the situation.
Well, I just walked in and started pounding away at the police station, and then people could hear it, so they all came up and started throwing rocks and stuff. Not a lot of people, not as much as the police witnesses there. So
they were along here, like throwing rocks from here?
That's where you see me over here going into the gate over around that area with the shovel.
Lex Watton was sentenced to 7 years for inciting the riots, but was released after serving almost 2 years in prison. A 4-year gag order prevented him from speaking about the incident publicly until July this year.
I'd still do what I did then. It was about making a statement.
Even though it cost 2 years of your life in prison?
Yeah, not only my liberty, but, you know, the suffering of my family. I know they went through a lot. Don't regret whatever ever happened. I don't regret it at all.
But the family and community were still seeking justice. And after several autopsies, inquiries and court cases, the man accused of Cameron's death, Senior Sergeant Chris Hurley, the first officer in Australian history to be charged over an Aboriginal death in custody, was charged with manslaughter and assault in February 2007. But 4 months later, he was acquitted of the charges. Lex Watton is now leading a class action against the state of Queensland on behalf of those impacted by the riots.
Overall, it's a way of the community, in whatever way they've been affected, to get some sense of justice or support for all the past wrongs that have been happening at that particular time when it comes to the arrest.
Prominent Aboriginal human rights activist, Professor Gracelyn Smallwood, is hopeful that this will bring closure to the community.
It's not about money, it's about justice and letting the world know that the unresolved trauma is still there on Palm Island. And every Bulgarman person on Palm Island suffered so much trauma through this death, like every community member suffers when another Indigenous person is taken in custody and doesn't come out alive.
But while the community and its leaders of Palm Island commemorate the passing of Cameron Doomadgee, they're also determined to work towards a more positive future.
Elizabeth has put in and had some discussions with me around getting a proper monument or a plaque done for the family. So I'm making some inroads in terms of trying to negotiate and get some support. The council vision is quite clear, is that, and certainly me as the mayor of the town, is that we have to create our own opportunities, I think. I'm making it quite clear to government is that we don't want welfare programs. We don't want a welfare reform. We don't want an empowering project in this community. We want economic prosperity. And I think that's the way to the future, particularly for our younger generation, is that we've got to provide a good platform for them, set a direction in terms of there is a future and it's up to you to build that future for this community.
Hello, Cameron.
But the Doomadgee family are still seeking justice.
We can't just give up now. We've been through a lot and we need to keep on going. Because we know our children is our, you know, their next generation for us. And they have to be strong-minded to push, because I reckon we still really need to get justice.
Lex Watton and his family continue to pursue a class action against the state of Queensland on behalf of the people of Palm Island. Still to come on Living Black, the issue of indefinite detention.
Locking them up indefinitely, in my way, is a very expensive and very ineffective solution to that problem. We ought to be looking at a management solution which places them at a level of risk which the community can accept.
You're watching this special justice episode of Living Black. Last year, we spoke to a mother calling for the release of her mentally impaired son, held in a Western Australian prison for over a decade. Due to his impairment, the man has never stood trial or been convicted of an offence. It's a legal loophole allowing mentally impaired people to be detained in prisons indefinitely. Due to legal reasons, we've changed the names to protect the identity of the son, who was only 14 years of age when he was sent to prison. Laura Murphy Oates investigates.
He reckon, no, I'm back home. So I was like, no, that's not your home, you can get out. But he's like, no, I can't get out, I'll never get out.
Sarah and Kyle have spent a decade fighting for the release of their son, Jason. Sarah is suffering from kidney failure, and as her health deteriorates, she's desperate for her son to be released. Back in 2003, Jason was just 14, the oldest in a family of five living in the southeast of Perth.
Just happened, you know, like a young bloke.
It wasn't as if they intentionally went out to do that, and plus they was only kids themselves.
One day, Jason broke into a car with his sister and young cousins, one as young as 10. They headed off with Jason behind the wheel.
The police got behind him then and put the siren on. When he went to turn and another car come and hit him on the side, and that's when the car rolled.
Jason's 12-year-old cousin died at the scene.
It was a long time ago, but, you know, it seems like it was still fresh in your mind.
The teenager was brought before the Perth Children's Court to face charges over his cousin's death. What they didn't know then was he would spend the next decade of his life behind bars without ever being convicted of an offence. He was deemed by the court to be too brain damaged to stand trial, reportedly the result of solvent abuse.
You see lots of people doing it, young and old, and then they say that it might have affected his brain.
At the age of 14, Jason was sent to a Perth juvenile detention centre to be locked up indefinitely. This is not the only case of its kind. There are currently over 30 people held in Western Australia under the same law, about a third of them Indigenous.
My concern is that there have been a number of cases in which there is no doubt that a person who's been declared unfit to plead under the Act has spent much longer in prison than they would have spent had they been found guilty. And that just seems to me to be wrong.
In your opinion, is jail the safe place to be placing these people?
Locking them up indefinitely, in my way, is a very expensive and very ineffective solution to that problem. We ought to be looking at a management solution which places them at a level of risk which the community can accept. Of course, if they are very dangerous, then prison may be the only alternative. But very few of the people that we see in the courts are within that category.
He believes prison is not always the right option, but currently in Western Australia, it's the only one. If you've committed a crime, but it's found you're either mentally ill or cognitively impaired, and it's proved you lack capacity at the time of the offence or cannot understand court proceedings, you come under the Act. Instead of facing a conviction, the judge has two options: to let you go unconditionally or to place you under an indefinite custody order, reviewed annually by a board. If you're mentally ill, you can be placed in a hospital, if there's room. Otherwise, you're held in a prison. If you're cognitively impaired, you can be placed in a prison or a declared place, meant as a secure, kinder alternative to prison. But the catch? These declared places do not exist. They've never been built.
Plainly, we are behind because there is still no declared place under the Act, and the Act's been in force for decades.
Currently under construction, this Disability Justice Centre is scheduled to open mid-next year. When opened, it will be the first time in the 18 years of the Act that someone with a cognitive impairment can be placed somewhere other than prison. Dr. Morgan reports to the WA Parliament on prisons and detention centres. His recent report is highly critical of the Act. Care for the mentally impaired in prison comes under the corrective services budget, which Dr. Morgan says can only stretch so far.
But really, to get to the stage of being ready for release, it's very important that they have access to relevant programs in prison, otherwise their risk will be exactly what it was or more than when they went in. And one of the difficulties we've got at the moment is we do not deliver enough programs in prisons to people with cognitive impairments.
Hey Neil, just on that.
Joseph Walliam liaises with Indigenous people on custody orders and sees the challenges that are faced.
Aboriginal families will agree to conditions to get them out of that kind of environment. Fully thinking and wanting to make sure that he doesn't breach.
He believes the conditions placed on their release are incompatible with Indigenous culture.
These conditions placed on these people with mentally impaired doesn't allow them to go to a funeral, participate in ceremony, because mentally impaired people don't stop living and they need to take part in things that are important to Aboriginal people.
In Jason's case, release plans have failed time and time again.
And because he was in an angry mood, his parole board breached him and sent him back to prison. Then he went back in for another 3 years before they tried to release him out again.
But there are moves underway to change the law.
Why should a person who has a mental disability be sent to prison indefinitely, where a person who is fit to plead and is guilty receives a smaller term? It's wrong.
The Shadow Attorney General made a failed bid to amend the Act earlier this year. He was told he did not have support because a review is already taking place.
We've been hearing about reviews for years, yet people are languishing in prison unjustly at the moment.
The decision about whether or not a person subjected to an indefinite custody order is a political decision by our government, and it will be much fairer for the courts to be making that annual review.
One of the paramount considerations is the safety of the community and also the safety of the person concerned.
The Attorney General says the legislation is not necessarily to blame.
The Act itself has come under some criticism. I don't think actually there's too much flawed with the idea of the Act.
Any legislative change is still as far off as next year. But after more than 10 years, Jason is losing hope.
Yeah. He rings me up every night, just check on, see how I am. A bit worried now that I'm in hospital and make sure that everything's all right with me. Only thing we can hope for that the justice system will change so that it might give him a chance to get out and do something with his life.
In the meantime, Jason's family will continue to fight for his release in the hope that he will finally have justice.
An update on that story, Jason is still being held in a Western Australian prison with no release date. A disability justice centre is set to open in Perth in July this year, and Jason's advocate is hoping he will be one of the first to be considered for transfer. Still to come on Living Black, anti-protest laws in Tasmania.
In this state, if we didn't have the right to protest, we'd never get nothing done, especially when it comes to Aboriginal issues.
Welcome back to this special justice episode of Living Black. Late last year, the Tasmanian Liberal government passed controversial anti-protest laws aimed at protests against the forestry industry. But there were widespread concerns the new legislation could silence free speech in the state. Hannah Hollis was in Tasmania as the new bill was about to pass through Parliament.
It's the smallest state in the country, but a controversial new bill is making big headlines across Tasmania.
Well, basically, it's another way to shut us up, isn't it?
Nathan Maynard believes in his right to free speech, but proposed legislation could silence the community. The 34-year-old Pakenham man has been standing up for what he believes in all his life.
I just think it's disgusting. I just don't know what kind of society we're living in. I thought we fought against these rights many years ago, and now we're here in 2014 and we're doing it again.
Only
if additional areas were added to compensate.
Tabled by the Tasmanian Liberal government earlier this year and passed through the lower house in June, the Workplaces Protection from Protesters Bill could make protesting illegal. Under the Act, an individual promoting awareness or support for an opinion about political, environmental, social, cultural, or economic issues in or nearing a workplace can be fined $2,000. A second offence will incur jail time of up to 2 years. Sarah Maynard from the Tasmanian Aboriginal Centre says the law is systematically flawed.
I think we need to kill the bill. There is no need to have such a law in Tasmania. It's counterproductive. I think the Liberal Party really didn't read this bill before they rushed it through the lower house, because there are so many people in Tasmania and there's a huge amount of people in the Aboriginal community that are just laughing at the Liberal government right now, because this bill is just so ridiculous.
Throughout the state's history, the Aboriginal community has been active in protesting for land rights, giving them the ability to lobby against any political decision.
Like, they actually put the piles to support the bridge in the Aboriginal site.
In this state, if we didn't have the right to protest, we'd never get nothing done, especially when it comes to Aboriginal issues, especially regarding Aboriginal heritage, Aboriginal handback of land.
If the bill is passed through the upper house, Tasmania will become the first state in the country to impose mandatory sentencing laws against protesters.
They risk catching all kinds of people who wouldn't be considered by the majority of the community as extremists, and simply could be people in a public place expressing a political view. So we were very horrified and very concerned when we first saw this legislation, and we've been campaigning strongly to have the legislation removed from the Tasmanian Parliament.
According to Civil Liberties Director Richard Griggs, the bill risks violating the people's basic human rights.
All citizens have a right to engage in civil society and to discuss ideas of political importance. Not only discuss those with their politicians, their elected representatives, but also to discuss those with the media and take to the streets in protest. This law, because it would create mandatory prison terms for peaceful protesters, there's a real question about whether it infringes and impedes the Australian Constitution.
The context behind the legislation has been called into question.
Well, initially the government said that they were going to do something in relation to environmental protesters, and particularly people who've protested against what is an environmentally unsustainable forest industry in Tasmania. But they've overreached massively, and it risks now catching pensioners who might be protesting against the federal budget. It risks catching any kind of environmental protest. It risks catching people who might want to blockade against a super trawler if one should come down to Tasmania, as looked likely a few years ago. And it also risks catching Indigenous Australians who want to protest to protect their sacred places and their land from inappropriate development.
In a statement to Living Black, Paul Harris, the Minister for Resources, said the government believes in the right to protest, and after listening to a number of stakeholders, have proposed amendments to provide clarity for perceived ambiguities, such as reducing the $2,000 on-the-spot fine to $280 to first-time offenders and confining the laws to forestry, agriculture, mining, construction and manufacturing. But others are not convinced those changes will remedy the issue.
Legislation is too poorly drafted and too draconian to be fixed up by amendments. It'd be like putting a band-aid on a bullet wound. It's just not going to do the job.
The story has attracted international attention and has been condemned by the United Nations.
The bigger problem for a democratic society like Australia, and one of the reasons why we paid attention to this so much, was it's inconsistent with the basic needs of a democracy to allow expression.
Risdon Prison here in Tasmania is predominantly a correctional facility, and under the proposed laws, if you're caught protesting for a second time, this is where you'll call home for at least 3 months. Critics are wary the punitive sanctions are likely to strain prisons.
It's an inappropriate use of the prison system. The prison system should be used by government to keep the community safe. It should not be used by the government to frighten the community into silence.
It costs over $300 a day to keep someone in prison in Tasmania, and that's reflective in broad terms of the costs around the country. And it's a horrendously inefficient way of a government doing business.
Time spent behind bars brings with it a range of consequences.
Putting someone in jail gives them a criminal record, and this would be a criminal record because it would be classified as a crime. And that can lead to a lot of challenges in people's lives in terms of further education, in terms of international travel, and of course in terms of employment opportunities.
But for those like Nathan Maynard, he's willing to take the risk for the right cause.
Would it stop you protesting if this legislation was passed?
Well, I'd have to pick me battles, that's for sure. If every time I went to protest it looked like I was going to get locked up, it definitely made me think twice.
While the Tasmanian government tables the legislation in the upper house, regardless of the outcome, the community won't be silenced on this controversial issue.
Hannah Hollis with that report. And after significant changes were made to the bill, the anti-protest laws passed through the Tasmanian Parliament in November last year. And that's the program for today. If you'd like to watch this episode again, just visit our website at sbs.com.au/livingblack. You can also follow us on Twitter and check out our Facebook page. On behalf of the team, thanks for joining us. I'm Carla Grant. See you next time.